As Thomas already mentioned, then we in PA Consulting have made a number of reports in collaboration with Copenhagen Fintech. Back in 19, we published one around partnerships. Then last year, we did one around boards, which naturally is highly relevant for the session we have today. And then just in a few weeks' time, we are publishing the report around building a fintech to scale. And all of these reports are based on surveys with several fintechs. The report from this year had 80 respondent fintechs in it. And then in addition to that, we have had between 15 and 20 interviews with fintech CEOs and experts within the domain as background and info for these reports. So these reports are a playback of what we hear in the ecosystem. And the themes of these reports also speak to the journey that there's been in the fintech ecosystem over the past years, where we see an increasing maturity, as I'm sure that you can recognize as well. And first, just some findings on our report from last year around boards. What we found in that report is that the vast majority, 70%, of fintechs actually believe that a board is a critical success factor, which is very much in line with what Thomas just explained. However, it was also quite surprising to us and quite an interesting finding that less than 50% of the fintechs actually believe that their board has delivered in line with their expectations. And on a very high level, we found two reasons for that. The first being that fintechs aren't always sure on how to use the board. And secondly, board members aren't always sure how best to advise when it's a fintech that they are advising. But how do you then turn your board from a pain to a gain, as it says here? In our report, from our research, then we derive these three elements, these three themes that ensures a successful collaboration and a successful board. And the first theme relates to why actually having a board in the first place. Is a board and is this additional layer of governance actually the right decision for this given fintech? Or might it be that the fintech needs more an informal advisory board or simply a number of key contacts and key relationships in his or her network that they can call upon for advice? From our research for this year's report, we also found that as a fintech is maturing in its scaling journey, more and more of the founders and fintech executives, they recognize that a fintech board is simply a key to their success. The second element or area of finding from this report is in relation to the competencies of the board, which competencies that it actually need. And here a key finding in the report is that this competence mix shouldn't be static. As you can see, there's quite a high number of fintechs that aren't really satisfied with their current mix of competencies. And this mix should be evolving as the fintech scale, as it'll be different challenges that the fintech has in front of themselves. And thirdly, in terms of how a board should operate when it's in relation to a fintech, we found quite a big clash here, because the fintechs themselves, they wanted the board to be somewhat near to the operations and be able to assist them also on operational matters. Whereas the majority of the board members wanted intentionally to keep some distance to the operational part of the fintech to be able to increase their focus on the longer term and strategic issues. So this balance is something that needs to be explicitly addressed between the fintech management and you as board members. And this is a quite hard balance, and that's why an open and honest discussion and debate around this is critical. That's at least what we heard from all the interviewees in that report. I'll share a link to the full report here in the chat afterwards, and in that you can also see a video of a 10-minute or so presentation where two of my great colleagues go into a bit more details around the findings of this report. But as time is a little scarce, I will move on and talk a bit about our report that is coming up here in just a few weeks' time. And in that, we, among others, present a few interesting numbers and stats. And as you might have heard here initially in the FinTech Week, then already now in the first 8 months of 2021, we have surpassed, or the FinTechs have surpassed, the total number or the value of the total number of investments. So already now in month number 8, we are further ahead, so to say, than in what was the case in the entirety of 2020. Quite impressive. What you might not have heard yet during this week is stats around the average investment sizes of the investments that goes into the Danish fintechs. And what's really interesting about this graph is that, as you can see, it's not just pocket money, it's serious funds that are going into serious fintechs and serious companies. However, what we have also found during our interviews is that, of course, funds don't leave to scalability in itself. There needs to be much more, of course. And during our research on this report, we found that there were three key elements to success in terms of scaling. And these are, as you can see here, creating a roadmap. It is about finding the right skills. And it is thirdly around building your network. And these seem quite intuitive. They indeed are quite intuitive. When we talk to the fintech executives, when we talk to experts, they all recognize that it's not necessarily hard to understand that these elements are important. Nevertheless, the fintechs emphasized different elements in relation to these three themes where they are quite challenged and where they could need support and input from you as board members. So first, around the roadmap. When you're a fintech startup, it might be sufficient to focus most of your roadmap around your product or your platform. But as you scale and move in that scaling journey, then you need to ensure as a fintech that your roadmap covers the entire business, including the back office, compliance, etc., etc. And this is an element where you as board members really can support the fintechs. Also, in terms of balancing the roadmap, then fintechs highlighted that, of course, they need to build a high quality and scalable product. But they also know that they have to move really, really fast. And how do they then balance this? This is another element that several of the fintechs executives highlighted that this is challenging for them, and another element where you as board members can support them. In terms of finding the right skills, for me personally, that's a very interesting one. So I've decided that we'll just double click on that in just a second. So moving down to the third area here around building a network. Every single person that we talked to during this process knew and mentioned to us that building a network is important and that it can help with multiple things for them. However, finding the right time is really the challenge. Oftentimes, when you're in a startup, you end up fighting a lot of fires. So really having someone that helps push you on this agenda of building a network and maintaining it is really something that is helpful for the fintech executive. And it can be something as simple as one told us, well, ensure that it's in your diary, because there's just a larger chance that it will happen if you are intentional about it and schedule it. And as I promised, then we'll just double click on finding the right skills, and that's skills for the entire organization. And as it says here, if you could only focus on three elements to ensure that you have the right skills in the organization, it's this year. You need to ensure that your leadership team is evolving as your fintech scale. It's not the same competencies as is needed and which have been a critical element of the success for a fintech up to, say, 50 employees that will be needed to go to the next 300 or even more employees. So here you need to have a leadership team that is really, really proven to be able to manage this. And what are the skills then that a leadership team should have? Well, when you're a startup, it might be one-to-one enthusiasm that you should be good at. But when you're scaling, it should be reading an organization and leading leaders. And I'm naturally not saying that a fintech should change their entire leadership team. I think we can all agree that Jeff Bezos and others did quite all right, but I think that you get the point around this. In relation to the employees in the fintech, then again, as a startup, then it's excellent to have a lot of those that we can call startup people, typically a bit younger, who are generalist and really love this culture and are really in favor of all the creativity. However, those skills are not the only right skills, so to say, as the fintech scale. As you scale, you need to have more specialists than generalists, and then you need the specialist to collaborate naturally throughout the organization and ensure that it doesn't become a handover from one specialist to another. And as it's also said here, a lot of the interviewees that we spoke to emphasized that it can be a huge advantage to go international as well when looking for employees. It can also help in terms of funding, it can help in terms of local market knowledge when expanding to other markets, etc., etc., etc. And the third element in relation to this is to take control of your culture. One interviewee told us that to successfully scale, you need to maintain your culture. It's absolutely critical that you do that, otherwise you won't succeed. Then the very next day, a colleague and I had another interview, and this person said, you need to change your culture, otherwise you won't be able to scale. It's critical that you do that. So what can we get out of this? What we can get out is that you need to be conscious about it. As you double or even triple your number of employees in this fintech, then culture can and will change, and that's for better and for worse. So you need to be conscious, and this is where you as board members also can go in and advise your fintech. So again, just to summarize, it's around creating this business-wide roadmap. It's around finding the right skills throughout the organization, and it's about helping the fintech to ensure that they have the right network. If you want to hear more about our reports here, then you're more than welcome just to reach out to myself or one of my great colleagues here. And unless there are any specific questions to me, then I will hand it back to Thomas.
Great. Thank you so much, Andreas. And I think that sets the scene very, very nicely for us to take the discussion and move that on. I'm just checking here if there's any questions. So again, please, if there's any of you out there that has any questions to this, just fire them away in the chat, and then we'll probably gonna ask you if you're okay with joining us on stage and asking the question yourself, or you can also write in the question that you would like me to take it. So that's also perfectly fine. So just to pick it up from there, because I think one of the overall interesting facts here is that 70% of the startups, it's not that the startups doesn't find that boards are important. So 70% says it's actually important. Only 46% says it's, you know, they actually derive value from it. So how do we, I think in your words, how do we move from pain to gain? And I think that is as a perfect segue into maybe asking you, Susanne, from your experience as a board member and investor in fintech startup, how do we move from pain to gain? How do we derive more value out of, or as a startup, how do we get more value out of your, the board work, in your opinion?
Mm. Yeah, it's a super good question. And I mean, the number is quite quite interesting. But also, I would, I have to say also, I think in line with what I see talking to a number of fintechs. And I think a lot of it is about setting expectations, right? That that we don't spend enough time when people join boards or when the company hire or get in board members. We don't spend enough time on making sure that it is the right persons with the right time on their hands to work with the fintech and with the right competences and all of that. Especially, I think, for very early startups, it often becomes... you know, they're just so happy that there are some people who would actually like to join the board, so they can go a little bit, you know, they go a little bit too fast, in my opinion, that they just, so it becomes a little bit a family and friends board in the beginning, and just happy that some people are actually there to help and guide. And then when they get the first funding or the first money, it becomes a little bit more professional with some of the venture funds or business angels joining joining the board. But then they also have their own, you know, they're also owners, but then they're also sitting in the board. And sometimes they get confused about these different hats. Am I now actually working for the company sitting in the board? Am I working to gain the maximum out of my own money that I have either invested or got in options in the company? So that is also kind of a, sometimes a conflict. And then it actually takes, in my opinion, you know, first until the next stage where, and the next step before they get more professional, the company and the board, where they actually start thinking about competences and diversity and what do we really need for the next phase of the company, of the stage of the company. And then I think you get the better, then the company has matured, there's been a number of maybe mistakes they've had on their board, maybe they've had some experiences, and then they also become more professional in their hiring phase of who do they actually want, why is it important, and how can we use them. But I also see that board members, there are so many who would like to either get on their CV that they're actually a board member, to be blunt, or to have that as part of their CV, and or they think it's something we can do and meet every other month. We can have a meeting and I can just, you know, have an opinion at that meeting and then that's it. But fintechs, and especially startups, early startup companies, they need much more than that. I mean, you cannot be, in my opinion, sitting in a board and then work from your Eiffel Tower and then just sometimes kind of fly in and then, you know, how are things going? Is it going fine? And then fly out again. You have to be much closer to the company. And I don't think that, and maybe not all board members have realized that or have the right know-how or realistic view about what it actually takes to sit in a board, and I think that also makes, I mean, does that the expectation levels are so different between you know, what the company can actually expect and what the board member is actually willing to put in and invest in of time in the company.
I think that's is a super important question that I would like to maybe dig a little bit deeper into. Also, how do we create that balance and not become too operational? But that's just because I see there's actually a question, and I think it's actually towards you, Andreas, here. It's just, are those three crucial points only knowledge from the interviews, or are there any other evidence behind? And I know you're not super involved in the first report, so I don't know if you have, but I'll let you to answer anyway.
Yes, happy to do so. And I assume that it's the three elements around creating a roadmap and finding the right skills and the network. Is that right understood?
Exactly. Maybe we can, Lars, would you be okay with being, if we drag you on stage here? To see if we can invite Lars to stage, because then you can we can let him ask himself. Or I think Lars is joining us.
Hi. Yeah, hello. Joining you from Fire in the southern part of Denmark. No, it was the other three, the three really interesting things about that you need to focus on: change your leadership, hire specialists, and take control of your culture. I found those. Oh, sorry.
It's okay. Good. We can hear you. All good.
Right. No, I thought those three was really interesting, and actually some that I also feel in my daily life. So I was curious whether there was any literature or behind there, or it was mainly evidence from your interviews.
Thanks.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
Yeah. So in terms of whether there are literature on the topic, I'm quite sure that there are. Our reports are practical in nature, and they aren't intended to be anything near a PhD. So those three advice are based on the approximately 15 interviews that we have had with fintech executives and with cluster organizations in the Nordics and key employees in incumbent players who have partnered with fintechs, etc. So that's the practical point of view that we have synthesized and summarized.
Cool.
Okay, thanks.
And then I'll just jump back. I'll jump back and then try to include you, Thomas, because from your perspective as a, I guess, both a practitioner, but also in this context, from an academic and a research perspective, and especially from the interviews that you have done now with the faculty around designing the education. How does the point from Andreas resonate with the findings in the interviews and your general view on board work in startups?
Let me start also there where Susanne had her argument. Of course, it is, let's put it, embarrassing that over half of the companies don't feel that their board is adding value. Let's put the, so look at the elephant in the room. But I would also like to say, like Susanne pointed out, I like to put things into boxes because then I can keep it organized. There are these fintechs who want a board. They haven't thought about it, what they want it for, but they think it's pretty cool to have a board. And that resonates with Susanne's point. Then they are happy that somebody actually will sit on the board, if that is family or some known figure from the industry and so forth. But they haven't really an idea what should create value. And by that, then they may get disappointed what it is, because the clearance is missing of what actually we are here for. Then the next one, the next box of my three boxes where I can put startups in is they must have a board. And Susanne mentioned that also, you know, as soon as there comes a VC in or any other, or you take a loan in the bank or anywhere else, then there's a demand. So it's not out of love that they have a board. They must have it, and they feel that pretty intimidating that they now have other people to respond to. And then the third box is, of course, they value the board. And this is actually what we would like to raise that bar of how can a board create value. But it starts by that the startup actually wants the board to create value. And then we can discuss where we are and how we're going to do that and what the board is. And in response to also the question in the chat, but in general, and that was also a point in the interviews, how operational should the board be? And again, different situations. The board in itself, if we take sort of the classic academic boring answer, the board is above the management team, yeah, and they do other things than the management team. But of course, they need a good relationship and a good working culture to deal with each other. But it's a crucial element which we discuss on all our courses. How do we divide? Who is making decisions on what? So that there is a clear cut about that the decision is taken, but also that there are not two bodies, i.e. the board and the management team, taking the same topic, but different decisions, and then there is conflict. And it's very operational in that way that very often in very early phases, the board is much more an advisory board than it is a practical working governance board. And that is a huge confusion, which there is in practice. Because if you are basically the marketing department or the finance department or the CFO or whatever department of the organization that's typical, but it's not really according to the book. And that's one of the key dilemmas. How much are you basically part of the operations and not part of the governance structure? And is there one true answer? No. But I think it's very important for all companies to discuss where the borderline is, to be explicit about when a board member also on top of the board role assumes an operational role, so that everybody knows when do they have these different hats on. I think that this is, it's a matter of clarity. And of course, the final product, then the board is not part of the operations, but that is when you have had your IPO and you are in the newspaper that you are the new unicorn.
Okay, so let me just, because I think one of the most asked questions that I think we as an organization get actually when startups come to us, that is kind of, first is like, or maybe we discuss a little bit, you know, what, why do I need a board? But then it very quickly goes into, so who should I invite to sit in the board? You know, so because, you know, who do I, you said like something with friends and families, investors, so the comp, and I think Andreas was also talking about that, the competence mix of a board, and I'm going to start off with you, Thomas, and then get your perspective also, Suzanne. So, and we also have a question in the chat here, I can see, but the competence mix, Thomas, can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, I can do. There are specific topics, areas which the board needs to look at. And that is everything from strategy to top management groups to reporting, financial reporting. This is in startups, often also related to finding finance for the next round. And if the board assumes these typical roles they have, then of course they need people who are competent in that. And it's rarely that one person can cover everything. So you will build a team around the core tasks of a board, but then we have what also the operational side hinted at. Then we have startups with very specific needs, and Andreas had it in his presentation, building the network, and the network was sort of for every different way of things. So suddenly we need someone who knows something about marketing or e-platforms, or not so much in fintech supply chain management issues, but some of the key capabilities in the area, and then that becomes a capability. But I think the general version is you need to understand what the company wants and there is what they need, and then map if you have these capabilities in the board, and then look for people who have the capabilities. And I also have to say, I'm not the greatest fan that the people with the money always get a seat on the board, because at the time they put the money in the company, maybe they have given the resource they have for the company. That's the money. So actually we need other people to do something intelligent with the money, but that's a controversial item, I know, but hey, we're having fun on a Friday afternoon.
All right. I'm going to hand it over to you, Suzanne, and then actually ask you the same question around, you know, in your view, how do you decide on the competence mix of the board? And then just right after that, I'm going to pull, Oliver to the stage, because he has a question around, you know, how operational you should be. So I will let Oliver ask that question and maybe elaborate on it a bit. But let's start out with the competence.
Exactly. I mean, I it's always difficult, because I think the founder of the company or the CEO of the company is, of course, doesn't, as Thomas is saying, I mean, cannot do everything, as none of us can, right? So you, of course, want to make sure that you have somebody in your board, potentially who can you know, fill those gaps that you may have. Normally, I would say in a board that you would have five, for fintech, you would have probably five different roles. One person might take multiple roles, but you would have normally one who has an industry knowledge in whatever industry you're in and who can help with that. You may have one who has a more commercial mindset and can help you on sales and all of that. You may have one who is very strong and can help you and support you in the tech and the tech roadmap and scaling that and make sure you have the right architecture. You might have one who is super good in funding, because that's going to be part of your life. So somebody who's well connected or who knows that game. and potentially one, because we are in this, as we will discuss later, one who is familiar with compliance or regulation, or can help you with all of that, depending on what you sell, of course, in your company. So I think at least you need somebody in the board to help you and guide you and coach you on those five areas. And then you can always find out whether you have one person or two persons, or who can, or five persons you need to divide it on. And then you were asking a little bit, Thomas, about where do I find these people? So, and I think today most are found through network, I would say. But then there are, you can look for business angels in Vækstfonden, for instance. You can go online, you can go to the hub, you can go to search on LinkedIn if you want. But I have to say that most that I know of is found through network or referrals from others. One thing that I would like to say that is, of course, one thing is the competences and capabilities of the persons. But I think another important factor is, of course, to ensure that you have diversity. Can mean men and women, can also, but it can also be age. So, I mean, if you are your target group are, you know, 20 something year olds, maybe you should have somebody on your board who's actually close to your target age, right? So there are different things that you should keep in mind. I think one of the and sorry if I'm going a little bit off beat here, but I think one of the most important thing for a company, a startup, when they choose to have a board, is to select the board chairman or chairwoman for that matter, because you know, as anybody else, and I mean, you as a potential board member, also looking at, you know, who's the chairman, who's the company you want to understand and love, the people you want to love in the company, but you also want to love the people that your new colleagues, which are the other board members. And setting the tone and setting the direction and being able to find the next interesting, competent board members is very much also driven by the board chairman. So I think, I mean, I cannot put enough emphasis on making sure you find the right one who can drive you. And that person probably knows other people with those competences that you need as well to fill the gaps. Yeah. Did that answer your question, Thomas?
Yeah, and I think no. Let's save that for later. Can we pull Oliver up and just get Oliver to ask his questions, because I guess this also comes from a bit of practical experience here. Hey, Oliver.
Hey, everyone. Sorry, I don't know, my camera's not. Maybe there it is.
There it is.
Great. Thanks, Susanna, also for the presentation. I had a question on how much time to spend, because you mentioned, okay, it's not enough that you add value through the board meetings. So how hands-on should you be? And I think this is a lot of the expectations with the startups as well, is very misaligned in both directions. Mm. Mm. And maybe as an add-on to that question is, like, coupled with what incentive structure? Because that's also, how do I pay my board members? Are they paid? Are they not? Is it a yearly fee? Is it equity? Yeah. Maybe you could talk about those two elements a little bit.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Is that to me or to...
Yeah. Let's start off you, yeah, and your experience, and then we'll jump into Thomas.
I think there are a lot of differences, but to start, there's also a difference between being the chairman and being a board member, I find. I think in the companies where I'm the chairman, I probably use at least 2 hours per week on the company. And that can be in the office, it can be in meetings and calls, whatever, but at least that every week. Because you need to be in quite close. And I'm also on calls, and they tend to call me at all sorts of times with questions or things or just news or, you know, both good things and bad things. So you tend to be quite close to the company and use quite a lot of time on them. And this is besides the normal board meetings and stuff like that. I think other board members will also need to use you know, maybe it's a couple of hours every 2 weeks, or I don't know, just to give an, again, give an estimate. It really also depends where the company is, and it's I have companies where I'm every day, if we are through an exit or we are doing funding or we are doing something where I'm quite involved, a new strategy or whatever, then I'm very much involved. Other times, when it's kind of more plain sailing, and we are, you know, it's less, obviously. So, but it's important to keep close, especially as chairman, I think. What do you get for your effort? And I think there's a big difference whether you actually invest yourself as well. Back to Thomas' model before, so you invest and therefore you're of course engaged and interested in the company performing, and then you you maybe take part of the board as an investor, you can say, board member, or whether you are not investing but getting warrants and potentially a salary for your work and time. Nobody, very few, does it for free, I guess. But I think and most, you know, I think for these smaller, some of the companies, just to give a size of salary, I mean, it can both be maybe 100,000 or 300,000 kroner per year. Most board startups prefer not to pay cash. They would rather give you some warrants. And warrants, I guess, can range between 1, 3, 4. Maybe there are people on the online who have a better. But I've both worked with models where you get maybe 2, 3, 4% warrants, and others where it's more cash and less warrants. And you know, so there are different. But that's probably the magnitude. And then it also depends whether you're a chairman or you're a board member.
Cool.
Did that answer your question, Oliver?
Yeah, it did. Thanks.
Oh, if I may jump into that again, the time you use is dependent on the role you play, and again, it was mentioned already in Andreas's presentation, it's a matter of negotiation or at least agreement transparency. So if I observe as the board the monitoring role, then maybe I come every now and then, look at some material, take some discussions, and that's it. That's typically not what the startup needs. The formal role is fulfilled, but the startup most of the cases need more or want something different. And what I also hear often in terms of time is if you are in a coaching role, that means as a board member, you spend lots of time coaching the team to understand what the board needs. So what kind of material would we actually like to look at, and not 2 hours before the meeting, but maybe you send it a week before, and that takes time. So many times, and as Susanne said, in particular, the board chairman will invest time for not investing time in the future, if that makes sense. So there's a training and learning and coordination process which can take some time. And of course, Susanne mentioned that higher time usage when there are significant turning points for the startup. Likewise, there is over time a movement, also in terms of payment, that you need and want independent members of the board. And of course, the independent members are independent because they don't have any shares, and then becomes the issue of paying them. And I also think if those profiles you want in your startup, you happily pay. So it may also be a test the other way around. If those people are all come for free, maybe the value creation is not there where it could and should be.
Yeah, it's a good point, Thomas. And just to add to that, what you're saying there is also that I've also seen that and heard from startups that if they first, they also feel that they can ask more of the board if they also pay them something, whether it's warrants or money. But then you get a better regulation, because sometimes I know the startups can feel a little bit, how much can I actually ask and call, and can I really call the chairman at night, or can I ask them to join the strategy session or meeting with the customer or whatever? But you get a different you know, there's a different dynamic if first the startup is actually paying or giving warrants to, because then they can ask a little bit better or feel that they can ask better for also getting some more time and advice. Yeah.
And so, because as part of designing this program, so I know, Thomas, you actually had interviews with each of the faculty members, including Susanne and the others that I mentioned in the beginning here. And what our ambition was also kind of not only to take what some might would say maybe the usual suspects from the Danish ecosystem, but also infuse some of the ambition and knowledge from outside of Denmark. So we also included some expertise from both UK and US. So in those interviews, Thomas, what was, because we focused a lot on, and I was in some of them, we focused a lot on the different dilemmas that actually are in the board work. So can you talk about a little bit, and maybe that's where we also talk about the content of the program, but a little bit about some of the dilemmas that we will be discussing in the program?
Yes, happy to do so. And of course, as a good professor, I always have a slide with me. In our world, when we do board education, there's the operational part that was about the dynamics and the meetings and the working and so forth. But the value creation, that's the key thing for us. Does the board create value? And we see and work with five tasks that also typically are the headings of our programs and what is in there. There's one big important issue that is that there's a corporate interest. The board needs to look at the firm and have the corporate interest. That's the focus, not individual investors, not individual people, the board as a community and the company as the focus of interest. There needs to be a strategy, and the board assumes responsibility that there is one. And there's direction. The governance, the board is the body which appoints the executive management team, at least the CEO that way around, and needs to make sure it's a good team. And also in itself needs to be a good team. We just had the discussion with the dynamics and who should be there and who is the chairman of the board and so forth. And then, of course, the reporting and risk management. So securing that the company can survive and is going concern, as well as, and that's a new point we have added for our startup portfolio, corporate finance. As Susanne said, it's a board issue to have financing rounds and organize that. And you better have also that capability in the board. Now, I have deliberately on that slide corporate, and everybody says, where's the startup? So yeah, we know that in startups, you know, it's completely different. And this is why we have a different program. The corporate industry, everything is driven by diversity. The founders have their own agenda, and not one, maybe two or three different agendas. There are lead investors, there are minor investors, and there's not necessarily a natural convergence. So that needs to be negotiated, and that becomes part of the board work, that they need to sort out who's who and how do we manage that. There may not be a strategy, or at least not a strategy which holds longer than 2 weeks. So where's the secured path? Most organizations are dependent on their founders, of course. But the founder is main investor on the board and the director. That creates lots of dilemmas the board needs to work with. There is a reporting vacuum, meaning that there's not an ERP system where you drag a report and you have standard procedures. All of that needs to be built, and they're always living on the edge. What we also, when we made the interviews, Thomas and I had what is particular, that these are startup dilemmas, which we build into the program and discuss and have cases around how do we do good and create value as a board. But the big issue in fintech is, of course, there's regulation. There needs to be compliance. It's different if you start a bakery and maybe the bread is not that good in the first week. But if you work with the financial infrastructure, you can do lots of harm, and there can be huge impact, and the regulator is right around the corner. And Susanne mentioned that as well, that it would be very good for a board to have access to these things, or in any decision, that's what also various people said in the interview, in any decision you take at the fintech startup, you need to think, do we now get into regulation? How can we keep out regulation? If we are regulated, how do we honor the regulatory requirements? So all of that we spin together in a 2-day program in order to discuss cases from the industry and to address these dilemmas, because there's no right or wrong. There's lots of ways of solving that, but we need to be aware of these problems, and we also need to find and know of good solution and best practice.
Cool. And I think that in a very excellent way answered also the difference between what you normally do with your corporate programs and what we're trying to do with this 2-day programs and some of the dilemmas that we are taking a deep dive into. So thank you very much for that, Thomas. I'm a little bit curious, because I think another thing that we also often get asked, that given you have a board and given that you already have some people on it, and given that what you already showed here, that this is very startups are pivoting and they're working in a very agile way, and you know what was right one day can be very wrong the next day, if there's some kind of shift and so on and so forth. So how and when do you know that you're, or how often do you assess that the competencies on the board are also aligned with where we are now at what stage? So I'm a little bit on, how do you take those conversations? And maybe it's not only on the board, but it's maybe it also ties back to the leadership team that Andreas also was alluding to. And, mm-hmm. and maybe you have some perspective on that, and then Susanne afterwards.
It's always good to make processes when times are good. So if there is a dysfunction in the board, and then you introduce board evaluation, which is also one of our most beloved key topics in our programs, then it sounds like we're having this process for getting rid of something. But proactively, it would be nice if the board agrees, how do we evaluate our own work? And how do we assess that? And then it becomes a routine. And in that routine, everybody must be honest with oneself, but also with the others. Do I feel that I still can contribute, and do I want to contribute? Or has the startup moved to a different phase that my capabilities actually are not any longer key for that? And if that is a routine and everybody knows their place, it's more like a sportive exercise okay, but then there's so many startups. Then you can use your abilities somewhere where it's really needed. But that would be something we would also highlight. If we have these evaluations, hey, we're not talking about long questionnaires and hours of interviews and so forth, but alone we have a routine which may be in the start a little bit low tech and so forth, but still comes to the point, did we add value? We also recommend that if the board has the last 15 minutes thinking about, did we do a good job today? Did we add value? That is the minimal form of evaluation. And alone that will create a tension between our existing capabilities and what we may need for now and the future.
And I'm just going to hand it over to you, Susanne. But building on what Thomas is saying here, what I'm curious about, and we haven't touched that much about it, but that is actually the whole scaling part, because that's also part of the ambition of this program. That making sure that even on a board level that we are having the right conversations around how do we scale this? How do we really fundamentally build companies that grow out of Denmark and scale? So again, in your experience, like the evaluation of the board work and when, especially in terms of having those competencies around scaling.
Exactly, and I think first of all, it's not, we don't unfortunately yet have a lot of competences in Denmark that have been through a scaling process from a fintech startup to a global company, right? But less can also do it, and I think and probably there are a lot of people who have experience from other businesses or industries where they have scaled fast in a number of ways where that you can use. But back to your first question, I mean, I think I was thinking when or smiling to myself when Andreas presented his leadership team should be evaluated either 2-3 years, because one of my strong points is that I think exactly the same for the boards. I don't think a fintech board should sit more than 2-3 years. I mean, in big companies, you can maybe sit for 5 or 7 years in a board, and then you should definitely see whether you should change yourself to something else. But I think for these startup boards, I think the company should hopefully grow so fast and get into other dimensions and dilemmas and things where they need other competences. So I think when you actually start hiring your board members to your startup, you should have an open discussion with them, saying, you know, what you could do and deliver. Maybe, and this is super fine now, but maybe in 2 years we need somebody with more global viewpoint. Maybe we need international board members. Maybe we need somebody who has scaled a business from A to Z. Maybe we need somebody with a marketing background, because now that's super important for us. So whatever, or supply chain management, or whatever it is. We don't know today, but we just know that when the company moves, the leadership team should move and the board should also move to new competences. So it's really important to find where are you in that and have that open dialogue. I don't think it's a shame, you know, to say now we need something else. It's just a successful, positive result that you have actually managed to sit as part of the board and help the company move to another you know, a new level where they're actually looking for new and other board members potentially.
Yeah. That's what we call the founder's dilemma too. You know, if you do a good job as a founder, you will be faster replaced.
Yeah.
I can see that we just crossed the 60 minute for the session. So maybe just to end it, and thank you so much. I think it's been a great discussion, and I really hope that this is a launch. So this is the formal launch of our board education. So I will just hand it over to you, Thomas, to maybe just spend 2 minutes. And I know we're a little bit over time, but I'm going to do it anyway. Spend 2 minutes on just giving a few more words on if you want to know more, where can you sign up, find more information, and then I'm gonna say thank you and a good weekend to all of the participants here. But first, over to you, Thomas.
Very fast. I already took the liberty to post the link in the chat. Otherwise, CBS Bestyrelsesuddannelsen can easily be found on the web, and there is the program. And a final word. We don't sell the right answer. When we teach our programs, we are teams of professors, of experts and practitioners like Susanne, and we discuss when we send groups as boards out in group work. It's board work which we do, and let them come with their decisions, and then we share how do we deal with these dilemmas. Our cases are always dilemmas where the answer is not given, but where we collectively need to bring in the intelligence in the room, both participants and the faculty team, in order to filter out how would value creation of a board look like in that situation, and what would be the different things. And hey, we are looking forward to run the program. Thank you.
And so that concludes. That's the final statement. On that note, thank you, Susanne. Thank you, Thomas. Thank you, Andreas, for sharing insights. And if you want to know more, go to the CBS webpage, and Thomas posted the link already. We will be sharing some more information, so stay tuned. This also concludes the last session of the Copenhagen FinTech Week. So thank you again all for joining, and hopefully see you at the board education. Thank you so much. Have a nice weekend.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.